Hey, Ramiro. Thanks so much for joining me.
Hey, Yanis. Thank you for having me. Very excited to be here and talk to you about open source, dev experience, and all those beautiful things.
Phenomenal. Thank you so much. Let's kick it off. Would you like to share some information about your personal background and how Okteto got started?
Yeah, of course. Happy to. It's a fun story. So, you know, my name is Ramiro. I am one of the founders of Okteto, the company, and also one of the maintainers of Okteto, the open source project. I've been a developer for my entire career. I've always been I've been lucky enough to always be in the cloud services and developer tools part of development. So, you know, Okteto solves a problem that I've had in my entire career. Like every time I worked in a cloud service, every time I built an API, there was always that complaint, annoyance of like, oh, it's so hard. You know, how do I get my code into AWS and validate that it works? How do I know that I'm building all these different microservices? How do I know that they're going to be working together well before I get to production, right? So this problem, especially as we move to containers and Kubernetes, is what drove us to start the project Okteto. And, you know, at a very high level, Okteto is it's a CLI tool that lets you launch your dev environment in Kubernetes and then gives you things like code synchronization, remote debugging, to give you this fantastic, or at least the way which I'm trying to do is to give you this great dev experience that it feels like your local machine. You write some code and then you see the changes immediately, but because they are applied to your dev environment in Kubernetes, you're not consuming local resources and things look a lot more like production.
I love it. Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. And my understanding is that this helps new developers get onboarded to a new project, as well as the team to manage this process. From your 15 plus years of experience and from talking to Okteto customers and serving them so far, what would you say makes a great developer experience? And how does it relate to open source as well? Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. This was something that we didn't, when we started Okteto, like dev experience and onboarding wasn't really like a top of mind. For us, we're very focused on like, hey, I want to write code and I want to have a fast, you know, inner loop. What we discovered is that, you know, for very experienced developers who understand, you know, all these levels in your stack, you know, you're just like I've been in space for a long time. So I understand DevOps, containers, code, infra, no, all those things. But as you talk to companies where they have teams with like very diverse skills, you know, like people focusing on front end, people focusing on business logic, others in like infra, others in security. One thing that kept coming up was like, hey, my developers are having a very hard time just grasping all these different aspects. And some of our early adopters kind of started talking to us, well, like, hey, you know, one really cool thing I like about this new world of cloud dev environments is that now my dev environment is codified on a file, which means that, and it's automated, which means that any developer can just run one command or with our commercial product, click a button in the UI and they're completely onboarded. And that became, I would say about 3 years ago, a very important topic in all of these companies who were hiring engineers, because it's like, hey, you know, now I can hire an engineer, and if the onboarding time is cut significantly, I can have them, they can be productive like the first week. And for, I mean, happens to me and maybe happened to you, you know, being productive is a lot of fun. Like joining a new team and being able to like send your pull request the first week or even the same day and seeing it in production, you know, get this high is very exciting. So we saw that 3 years ago, we started talking about that a lot. And as we talked about it, and as we kind of started building relationships in the open source world, we realized that this was a trend that was coming from multiple directions. There's all these tools, you know, in the dev tool space that were very focused on giving developers a great dev experience. It was no longer just solve a problem. It's solve a problem in a way that is easy to use, that is easy to understand. I mean, I think Docker was kind of like the first, in my opinion, one of the very first open source projects that really made this a core part of their mission. Like before Docker, and there were great products, right? But before Docker, I think usability, you know, the whole UX concept was not really that important. It's like, hey, it's a tool, it's hard to use, but once you learn it, you're really good at it. You know, like most things in Linux, most things in you know, these cloud providers. And then came, you know, Docker from the open source world. It was like, no, like we care about making it super simple. Docker up, Docker run. A lot of, so that to me was a trend. And then we saw that happening more and more. And now it's super exciting to see all these great open source projects, Supabase, Fig, Okteto, ChainGuard, CubeScape, all these projects that are solving what I believe are like very hard technical problems, security, how you distribute, you know, configure commands, and your IDE, Gitpod, and others. But in a way that is like, yeah, we have to make this easy for everybody and no longer just for like the hardcore, you know, developer that's obsessed and that is willing to spend, you know, like years learning a tool. Like, you know, I'm going to get in trouble here, but, you know, people who love like Emacs and Vim from the old days, and they had to spend a lot of time learning those tools, and they're very powerful once you learn them, but they're not easy to use. And then you see something like, you know, like VS Code, like Gitpod, and like, oh yeah, I can click here and it lowers the bar. And for me, that's something that I'm very happy to see, that more and more open source projects care about this and talk about not just the problem they're solving and not just like the technical aspect of it, but also the developer experience. I wish Kubernetes had spent more time on that before, but now there's only this ecosystem. Okteto is part of that, helping solve that, but it's definitely a very positive trend, in my opinion.
And it probably affects not just, you know, hiring and scaling the organization, but talking about open source, it's probably the main variable that determines the adoption and growth of the project. I mean, you guys see that every day, and you're eating your own food, and you have new people contribute every day. So would you like to take a step back and discuss the decision to develop open source software, and what has that looked like, from the simple things like, you know, picking a license to growing the contributor community?
That's really interesting, because you're 100% right in that having a good developer experience, it's just a net gain everywhere. Like, making a tool that's like, for us, when we started the Okteto, the project, one of the things we're focusing on a lot is this idea that you have 2 minutes, right? Like, if your user doesn't see value in 2 minutes, they're going to go do something else, because attention is expensive. We only have so many hours per day, and there are so many cool things out there that you want to like try. So, you know, you land on the README of your project, or maybe you have a page, and there's only very little time that you have to capture the imagination of the user. So having a good experience, a very easy to use, you know, now that's very much in fashion, that I love, is like, hey, single script, curl, in our case, curl downloads.okteto.com, bang, sh. And that gives you a binary installed, and then you do Okteto up on your repo, and that's what we, as a guiding light, that should give you some value. And what happens here is that if you capture imagination, then people use your tool. And in our case, because we're building a tool for developers, that generates, oh, I like this tool. Oh, I see it's really useful. Oh, I want it. I want to contribute. I want to not just give back, but like, hey, I want to improve it because I'm running into these issues. Like, very early on for us, what's really cool was like, one day when we build it, we're building it. We had this binary. We pick Go because I think Go for CLIs is great. Single binary works everywhere. So we had like this thing. And then one of our early users was like, hey, I love Okteto, but at work, I'm on a Windows machine and I can't execute those commands. And he just sent a PR, hey, would you mind supporting Snap? And Snap is like brew for Windows. And he was like, yeah, of course. Like, we never thought about that problem. We never thought about like, oh yeah, a developer in like a more traditional corporate environment that's using Windows, and they don't have admin access to their machine, but still they benefit from Okteto and they love it. He was able to just fix that problem for himself first, but through that, now it's like everybody who uses Windows, snap, install Okteto, or add Okteto, I forgot what the syntax is, and boom, the same thing, somebody else also added Okteto for like brew on Linux, and then now you can do brew install Okteto on Linux. And that was for me beautiful. I mean, I've been involved with open source for a very long time. So this model for me is a no-brainer, especially for things that developers use. Because it's just, you know, if you're truly building this for a broad audience, which is not always the case. Sometimes you're building this for niche or for very specific use cases in mind. Opening it up to more people with different levels of expertise from different parts of the world, which, you know, they have access to different resources, they see the world differently. It makes a better product, it creates a stronger community, and it makes for like a very fun, exciting, like we have a Slack and we have a community forum, and then you see people from all over the world, students trying to kind of get their feet in on, you know, on like professional development, and they use open source as a way to kind of start building that curriculum. People from like very well-known developers from like large companies who are using this tool. And they're like, hey, you know what? This is great, but I need you to support this other thing. And here's a patch. And they're like, oh, that's really cool. Yeah, we didn't thought about supporting that tool because, you know, it was not in our top five, but you send the PR, it works. It fits with our roadmap. Yeah, let's do it. That to me is one of the most amazing things about open source. And I don't think there's anything like that in the world for any other profession. It's kind of weird. Like, I don't know, architects putting, and maybe they do, I don't know, but like putting like their plans somewhere for everybody. I guess academia, you know, when you publish papers, you're sharing knowledge in the same way, but it's something that I find really magical, and I'm very glad that it continues to grow and become more accessible and easier. And to touch on something just really quick that you mentioned on licenses, licenses are helping this a lot because, you know, I've been around for a bit. So I've seen this change from the original open source licenses to like the copyleft to Creative Commons. Now, you know, Apache 2 becoming more standard. And the fact that we have a standard licenses that are easier to understand, that are more and more permissive and less dogmatic about it, it helps a lot because like 20 years ago, open source was a lot more dogmatic. And it was always kind of almost like, and it was this kind of very like, feisty, like, no, if you use my library, then you have to open source your thing too. And that was the way we're fighting it up. Now it's a lot more like, well, it's open source. You can use it whichever way you want, as long as you abide by these rules. And that makes it easier for individuals to use open source, for companies to build on top of open source, for corporate developers to use open source without this fear of like, am I going to get sued? Am I infringing on somebody else's copyright? So all of these things together, I think, are helping us build this thriving environment for everybody, which it's super exciting.
Absolutely. 100%. Thank you for touching on the licenses front. And I think you basically described one of the main superpowers of open source. Someone can find it, use it, improve it for themselves, but also make that improvement available to everyone else. And I mean, it's magical, as you said. What has the process... What I understand is because the user base is so broad and you're probably getting pulled in different directions, invariably, did you choose to focus somewhere in your conversations when you launched and onwards, like with bigger organizations or with the indie developer? How did you approach that? Because that's a challenge, I reckon, and other founders tell me in running the project. Yeah,
it's a big challenge, and it's something that, you know, we all have to learn it the hard way, but whenever you start a project, and this has happened to me, and it happens to everybody, I think this is natural. We always think, oh, this is for everybody. Everybody in the world will benefit from this. This is so cool and so powerful. And it's probably true. However, the reality is that reaching out everybody takes a lot of resources, takes a lot of time, and it's not realistic, right? It's like water, right? Everybody needs water. And still, there are like a million different brands of water or beverages, and nobody has a monopoly in the world because it's just distribution is really hard. For starting projects and, you know, starting companies or both like us, having clarity on who you're building this 4 is very important. One of the things that, you know, now that I've been on like on this kind of startup building game for a little bit long, for a bit now, it's been about 4 years. One of the things I wish I could go back and do is like be even more, build this for like even more specific audience. Because what we discover as we start to kind of get into the commercial aspect of our product and trying to like monetize our project and all those things is that the more specific you are in what you're solving, especially when you're going commercial, the easier it is to find an audience, to really understand what they need, and to make sure that you're serving them and you're prioritizing what matters for that specific, it's called personas, right? I think that, you know, if you're doing an open source project for fun and you don't care about adoption, it's a different story. But even when you do an open source project, right? Our case, Okteto, right? We could take Okteto in a million different directions. As you said, is Okteto for indie developers? Is it for corporate developers? Is it for people building apps of X, Y, and Z? Because I have this vision where like cloud dev environments actually benefit everybody, mobile developers, API developers, React devs, everybody. But commercially, we chose to focus on a certain segment, which is in our case, you know, companies who are building microservice-based applications that are using Kubernetes, that have a team of certain size, because that way, when we're thinking, hey, is this a feature we should build? Well, will it help this kind of companies? Well, maybe not. Or yes, like if you're building an open source project and you're not thinking of this as something for like the, you know, like the biggest enterprises, then you shouldn't build features like, I don't know, how do you onboard 100,000 developers at the same time? Like, that's not who you're going for. But if you're building for like that kind of audience, then you have to think about stuff like, what if they don't have pseudo access to their machines? What if they don't have permissions to add any binaries because it's unsafe? And that changes, and that makes it very interesting. It took me a while to learn of like, okay, yeah, I mean, things that are cool for me in my spare time are not that useful even to myself during my professional time because it's different. And that's something that, you know, if you analyze any of the very popular open source projects, you'll realize like you go deep, you'll see there's always this trend of like, they're really good at one thing. Like Vim, which is kind of an ongoing joke in the company. So when they see this recording, they'll laugh. It's an example of this. Vim decided on an audience. Vim is not for those who like to use their mouse. And they will never build a UI because their product is like, no, Vim is for those who like to use the keyboard and they don't like to change from the keyboard to the mouse. They want to do everything and they're willing to learn all these commands, and that's their thesis. And it's very important they don't deviate from that. Other projects have other focuses and they're like, you know what? They're for certain areas, and that's very important. And the sooner like everybody does it, the smaller you start, I think the easier it is to find those, you know, those super fans at the beginning. Because if you solve a problem well for like 20 people, and they're going to go and start your repo and tell their friends and tweet about it or write blog posts and tutorials about it, that's how you build. Like that's kind of when you see your adoption and your popularity climb like crazy.
I think this is golden advice. This is really important. So clarity on who you're building for and who you're not building for helps you find your audience faster, helps you prioritize. I should add, you probably introduce a tighter loop in terms of monetization, how you can go about generating revenue out of your solution and get those super funds. And of course, you can expand out of that. Of course, that doing that or not, you know, I guess it also relates to, you know, funding the project, you know, and supporting it in the sense that if you're building for the enterprise, for example, now, and you have all these features you need to deliver now, you have more clarity on what kind of resources I need to allocate them where. So would you like to briefly talk about how you have navigated this?
That's another very interesting challenge when you go from open source to commercial open source, which also I love that it's now a more important topic of conversation. You know, you have companies like Redis Labs, Elastic, there's like VC funds focus on this. It makes it a lot easier. But a key part here that I think it's important, it goes back to focus, is as maintainers, as people start thinking of like, okay, I'm gonna have this open source version, and then I want to monetize this. The same advice can help us a lot, which is, okay, have clarity on who are you selling this to. One of the most important things that I've learned in building commercial open source is that if you don't have clarity on the persona that is going to be buying your product and their problems, you're probably going to start giving away too much value, and then it's going to be impossible to monetize. Like we've seen, we all know a lot of open source projects. I won't name them because it can be a sensitive topic, that are very popular and they struggle to get anybody to pay. And there's all these stories of projects that, you know, are used in like large enterprises and nobody pays for them. Because that company wasn't clear on like, okay, well, how, what am I going to monetize this? I think it's very naive to expect that it's popular, so somebody will pay for it just because of that. Because in the old times, like, oh, support, they'll pay for support. It's like, well, it depends. Is that what the value that your customer needs? And that's what, in some cases, yes, right? Like some cases, like Red Hat built a very large business focus on a lot of it on like, hey, the enterprise is something Linux. The enterprise needs training, support, a legit kind of build that is recommended. And they build all these things. And, you know, you can get Red Hat, you can get RHEL for free, but you go to Red Hat and you pay them millions because you, as an enterprise, you want all this. So for us, when we were building Okteto, that was very clear. Like when we decided on was like, hey, you know what? The open source project, we're very focused on one person. You have you're developing, you want to launch a cloud environment, Okteto up. And if you have your own Kubernetes cluster, that works. And then we're thinking, okay, what do a company needs? And we had this framework of like, okay, a company needs a scale. It's not just one developer. Now you have 100 developers using the product. Well, what do they need? What do they care about? And it's like, well, the company cares about policies. It cares about permissions. It cares about self-service. They don't want to have, you know, every developer open an IT ticket every time they want to deploy an environment. The enterprise cares about the developers not using any random image on the internet, but actually using images that are pre-vetted. So as you go through this exercise of like who cares about what, you can start building kind of a mental model of like what makes sense to open source and what makes sense to commercialize. And I like that model because it allows you to build value for everybody, because I hate those projects where you artificially decide what's open source and what's not. And then it kind of feels like, is this really open source? Is it just kind of like pretending to be? And it's a risky and it's a very thin line. But having this clarity of like, okay, who are you selling this to? Are you selling this to the developer? Are you selling this to the engineering manager? Are you selling this to like the chief security officer of the company? Or now like the platform team, like we sell to platform teams, which means we have to focus on what do they care about. And, you know, platform teams care about all these things I was talking to you about. One indie developer doesn't care about compliance. It doesn't care about like image provenance because it's not an area of expertise and building it that way, I think helps a lot to give clarity to everybody, because it's also very important to give clarity to your customers. So you understand like, hey, are you going to support my needs? To your contributors, so they understand, hey, which areas we're not interested in developing for this project and which ones we are okay with. And to the end user, so they know kind of what to expect of your project. For me, like unmet expectations always leads to like grief and problems and accusations of selling out and all those things that happen a lot in the world of open source.
Absolutely. And I mean, again, thank you for covering this. And it, going a little more practical in terms of communicating that clarity across your organization, your users, your customers. And how do you go about doing it? I mean, you know, would you put it first thing like in the README, for example, so it's a little preemptive too? Or do you just, you know, tell people who come in with a suggestion? And that can be challenging. Like, how do you navigate it? Because everyone experiences that.
Yeah, it's very tricky. I have ideas on this. I don't think I have a good answer, but I think READMEs overall is something that open source projects should spend more time on? Because the README, or if you have a homepage, same thing, right? Is kind of like the how you present your project. So I think like, and it's really hard to do, and you know, a good README should leave this with very clarity. Like, what is the purpose of this project? What are the problems you're trying to solve? Having an open source roadmap, I think also helps kind of people understand where you are focusing on. And this part is very hard, but I think that maintainers who are strict and clear about the boundaries of the open source project make it better for everybody at any scale. Like explaining to like somebody who, you know, and it's kind of like this kind of work that never goes, it's kind of hidden, it's not really thanked, but it's crucial to an open source project. It's like somebody who goes through every time somebody files an issue and says, we're not going to fix this. We're not going to implement this because this is not our objective. Like going back to the example of like enterprise, so imagine that you have a project and someone says, oh, we should implement like user management. And you're like, well, no, because the objective of this open source project is to make it easy for one developer. We're not going to be investing in user management. We will not accept PRs of user management. And if you make it clear, like respectfully and explain, and I think over-explaining and over-communicating, and even to a point that says, you know what, that is part of our commercial offering. I think it's fair. Like people understand that we all have to, you know, work for a living. Somebody needs to fund all these open source projects. Money has to come from somewhere. And if you don't have a corporate backer, you need to find other ways. I think that helps a lot. Like, you know, it's always risky because open source is opinionated by nature and some people might disagree. And, you know, I haven't seen a major fork lately, but that used to happen a lot before. We're like, well, I don't agree with this. I'm going to fork the project and keep it with the same name, just like a two at the end, which actually happened. I forgot the name of that project, but I've seen it happen twice.
Comes with the territory is what you're saying.
It comes with it. Yeah, it's like any other community. You know, open source is a community effort. It's community led, or should be. It's people volunteering their time, their emotions, their feelings, their idea. You know, like people who build open source and contribute to open source are optimists at the end of the day. They are willing to give their time for the benefit, for something that, you know, it benefits you to maybe open source the code and change something. But going through the effort of like, I'm going to put this in a way that is compatible with the code base. I'm going to send a PR. I'm going to go through the process that sometimes can be like annoying. And there will be some friction because the maintainer will tell you, okay, this looks great, but please make these changes or make sure that you cover these other use cases. All that, it's all emotional, right? So if you don't feel like you're getting the respect and the kind of like the care, it creates this kind of friction, and then people are like going to get into fights and like, oh, these things. It's, which I think is part of the beauty, and that's why we've, I don't know, there's so many core infrastructure of the world that runs on open source projects, that is like Nginx, everything runs to Nginx, Linux, everything runs to Linux these days. It's kind of beautiful and it's super interesting. And that's something we all have to keep in mind and not forget that there are humans behind all of this and we have emotions. And that we have to take that into consideration as you build a community. It's a core part of it.
Community is number one, absolutely. If we could, and we sort of like touched upon it, also mentioning how commercial open source is, talked about more widely. If you could point your finger at it, what would you say has changed in the last, you know, few years in the space, in the commercialization, people's perception and overall, you know, because something feels different, right?
That's a good question. I never thought about it from that perspective. One thing, and you know, it's we now have very obvious examples of commercialization, of direct commercialization. Because before was, you had people building Linux for fun, you know, like Linus Torvalds and that group. And then you had companies that were like separate entities, SUSE, Ubuntu, Red Hat, and others, who commercialized Linux and made some money. And now what we've seen lately is companies like GitLab, like Elastic, like the company behind like Redis Labs, where like there's a clear kind of relationship between the maintainers and the people who are making the commercialization that I think is great, because it showed the enterprise that, hey, it's okay to buy commercial open source. You're going to get all these benefits and you have this backing plus the community. So it kind of creates this very positive, it's kind of like this virtuous cycle of like great community, which means great support, which means a thriving roadmap. You have the commercial backing because you're selling support contracts, because you're selling like a commercial tier. I think it became the cycle where then people became more agreeable with the fact that, yeah, there is a need for commercial. There are certain things that, you know, like going back to Nginx, Nginx had Nginx Plus. For a while, it was very controversial. Like, why are you gating these features only for paying customers? I think people understand that slowly, that, yeah, no, like we need to, people need to pay because you also need to pay the salary of the maintainers. And, you know, CI, CD is not free. Like there's infra bills to pay. I think it has changed a lot. And then as that grows, you know, there's been people leading this realm for a long time who are now kind of leading. You know, Okteto is a VC-backed company, so I'm also very involved in the VC world. I know other VCs who are, you know, have been beating this drum for a while, putting money into commercial open source companies in the last 2-3 years. Mm-hmm. JJ, friend of mine, Joseph Jacks, he has a fund which is called COSS, Commercial Open Source Software. Like his thesis is, I'm only going to be investing in commercial open source companies. The founder of GitLab, Sid, also started a fund focused on commercial open source companies. So once you have this funding, once you can go and find this, then more people are like, oh, I could start a company like that. And I can navigate this and benefit from both sides, which I find fascinating, because I've been building open source for the longest time and kind of having this avenue to be able to build open source, but generate a revenue stream, be able to create a company, which also helps guarantee the health of the open source projects, because now you have some backing behind. To me, it's really useful. It's tricky because you have to be careful. Like, and I think Kubernetes did really well, where it became a very large open source project, but no corporation owns it. That is tricky, but it's great. You know, this concept of foundations happening now and governing bodies, more for larger projects, is really useful. Mm-hmm. But even at kind of like the early stage level, having this backing, having customers who understand this model, having the whole open source model be more mainstream, which, I mean, it's been around for like 30, 40 years, but you know, it took a while for the enterprise to accept it. Even companies like Microsoft, where I used to work many years ago, they're a lot all in on open source, when like 15 years ago, they were like completely opposed to it. I think all that is contributing to making a healthier environment, a thriving environment, where, in my opinion, I don't see a downside. I think everybody benefits. Contributors, developers, maintainers, companies, investors, you know, public investors, whenever you become a public company. I think it's great. I think it's a great time to start a commercial open source company. And you know, for those who have open source projects, to think about ways that, you know, you can quit your job and find a way that you can work full time on that problem space that your open source project solves. That to me is like, it's a huge privilege and it's a lot of fun.
Absolutely. Thank you for summarizing that. That was actually a great answer on the and we are,
I'm glad I feel like it kind of went around, but I hope people can get like your listeners can get the gist of it.
Well, this was great. And so I know we're running out of time, but you've already said all this great advice. I just want to try to extract just a little more. So if I am starting today as an open source creator, and you already mentioned what's different today and new avenues that I have for funding and for, you know, growing the community. Of course, if I want to, you know, take my dev environment and codify it in a file and automate everything, I will use Okteto. So I have that option too. Is there any last sort of like snippet you could leave people with in terms of maybe a pitfall to avoid?
This is the number one advice I'll give everybody, and I'll give that to Ramiro 4 years ago if he could listen to me, is make sure that you're solving a problem that people care about first. Like, a lot of open source projects start by you have to solve a problem, in my opinion, that you have, right? It makes it a lot easier.
Right.
But make sure that it's a problem that more than just one person has. That is very important, right? And then you can start the project as well. Like, kind of trying to find early adopters is super important to kind of validate, hey, it's not just me. There's 20 other people in the world that also have this problem. That's enough. But to me, that's enough. You don't need to like find thousands. If you find 20 people, I'm willing to bet that if you find 20 people, there's 200,000 people. Like, we're not that different, right? And then the other, as you start thinking of commercialization, is make sure this is a problem that's big enough for people to pay money to solve. Because a lot of problems are important, but people are not willing to pay money to solve it. And that, to me, is one of those, once you unlock that, it's like, and sometimes it's a matter of like, how you phrase it, how you position the problem, how do you explain it to different people? That to me is very important. And number three, which was the hardest lesson for me to learn, especially if you go into like commercial software, is the person who uses your software is most likely not the person who's gonna buy it. And understanding that difference changes everything, because then you understand the buyer and the user. What do each of them care about? Because it could be like, Okteto could be great for me as a developer, but my boss is the one that has to go and get budget for it. So if he doesn't see value, if he doesn't understand the value proposition, then it's like, yeah, I'm not going to buy this. I don't care. This is like, doesn't seem useful. Do something else. And that is, those three things for me are like, it's kind of an evolution, right? You do one, then the other, then the other. But the sooner you can kind of figure this out, the more likely that you're going to be successful.
Absolutely. This is on point. Thank you so much. I really believe this will benefit a lot of people. I hope it has the reach.
I hope so. It was a very fun conversation. That's for sure.
it was really good. Thank you so much, Ramiro. I really appreciate the opportunity to interview you.
Thanks, Janice. It's nice meeting you. And thank you all. I'm on Twitter. If anybody wants to chat about this later, I'm always there. Twitter and Mastodon. Happy to chat there.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.